We have
You have up to 90 minutes if you want it, but feel free to take the time that you have available.
Okay. I guess it'll depend how many questions there are. But as an introduction, currently I'm involved with the Effective Altruism Foundation, which is in Switzerland and Germany now. They're a group of mostly German-speaking effective altruists, many of whom are focused on reducing suffering. And so they've got some different projects. One of them is the Foundational Research Institute, which I helped to start in 2013. And the goal there is to do very, like, as the name says, foundational research on topics relevant to reducing suffering, mostly in the far future, such as artificial intelligence trajectories, cooperation among competing factions, and other kinds of areas where we might have high uncertainty, such as like infinite ethics or other very broad questions that could crucially change our priorities. Other projects that the Effective Altruism Foundation does include Raising for Effective Giving, which tries to encourage poker players to donate some of their winnings to charities, and the project Sentience Politics, which tries to lobby for and do research on issues related to animal suffering. So one of the things that I'm involved with Sentience Politics with is research on wild animal suffering. We recently hired some people who have begun doing research on that topic for Sentience Politics. For example, looking at the humaneness of different pest control methods, both for vertebrates and invertebrates, the effect of poverty on wild animal suffering, and other analyses of that type. So yeah, I'm interested in shorter-term wild animal suffering as well as farther future suffering, especially resulting from different kinds of artificial intelligence. But I'm also interested in other kinds of meta-level issues in effective altruism, and I've been interested in this community since it started, basically. So feel free to ask any questions about any of those topics.
Great. Do we have any questions to open the floor?
Sure. On your website, Reducing Suffering, as a summary of your views, you put 50% probability on effective altruism reducing suffering in the long run. I'm just wondering what you think the movement can do to sort of move that 50% up to something much higher.
Yeah, so the important point about that statement is it says reducing suffering as opposed to like maximizing net welfare or something. So in terms of the probability that the EA movement will increase, say, a classical utilitarian utility function that gives significant weight to happiness, it seems more than 50%, maybe. Still not like close to 100%, just because there's always enormous uncertainty that you're making a positive rather than negative impact, but maybe closer to like 60% or something if you take a classical utilitarian welfare function. Purely from the perspective of reducing suffering, the main reason to be uncertain there is that colonizing space and creating vast amounts of computing power, which is a goal of many effective altruists, would entail a significant risk of creating enormous amounts of suffering computations in various forms, such as simulations of ancestors or other kinds of minds, or like lower level subroutines within computational infrastructure that could also be seen to suffer. So those kinds of suffering would be, to some extent, unavoidable given an explosion of computing power. There is a question of like how much suffering would have to go along with space colonization, but most space colonization scenarios would entail multiplying suffering to some degree. So insofar as many effective altruists want to increase the chance that humanity colonizes space, that's a potential area in which the EA movement could increase net expected suffering in the future, ignoring the happiness side of things. one reason that the number is not lower, the number that you cited, is that uncontrolled artificial intelligence would also, in my opinion, probably expand suffering, because it would have the same sorts of instrumental pressures for massive amounts of computation. So the AI safety movement, like, may potentially reduce some expected suffering, depending on your views about whether a controlled or uncontrolled artificial intelligence future contains more suffering. But yeah, so basically that number largely hinges on the net impact of AI safety and kind of related things that effective altruists put a lot of resources on. I guess other ways in which effective altruists shape the trajectory of the far future might be positive, like increasing compassion. But there's a lot of uncertainty even on those dimensions too. So as far as ways to change that number, so that, like, the easy way is to focus more on reducing suffering. In other words, like, change the goal function. optimizing better for reducing suffering will probably better reduce suffering. But absent that, I guess, one recommendation could be to focus more on AI safety and less on non-AI existential risks or extinction risks, because, like, non-AI extinction risks, even there, the question's complicated, but at least a naive view would say that non-AI extinction risks make colonization less likely, space colonization less likely, whereas with AI risk, space colonization will happen whether we get AI safety right or not, probably. And so within the AI safety space of futures, it's much more uncertain what kind of, like, working on AI safety doesn't obviously make suffering worse, and it might even reduce suffering probabilities of different kinds of outcomes. So AI safety is more neutral with respect to this concern about increasing space colonization. And relative to other kinds of assumptions that you might make, for example, that a non-human inspired AI would have less inhibition against running large numbers of suffering simulations for research purposes and things like that, then you might even conclude that AI safety work is good from a reducing suffering standpoint. So the general recommendation would then be to focus more on AI safety and less on non-AI risks. And fortunately, that's something that has been going on to a significant degree. Like, a lot of recent work on catastrophic risks has been on AI in the last 2 years. So that's a good trend from my perspective.
You mentioned that ethics is an area that new organizations you're associated with are prioritizing studying. The reasons that infinite ethics might be a priority, both from a sort of general EA or suffering reducing perspective.
Yeah, so one argument would just be that it's an area of significant confusion or uncertainty in general, and those tend to be places where unknown unknowns may lie. And so by definition, you can't really predict what an unknown unknown will tell you once you discover it. But beyond that, one example of where it could matter is there's a speculative possibility of creating universes in a laboratory. So this follows from certain models of cosmic inflation that have been developed, and it's not a mainstream idea necessarily, but some big name physicists think that it might be possible, and it's one example of a broader set of, like, possible things that physics might allow if we learn more about physics. So this is just one example and shouldn't be taken to be like this particular scenario is maybe unlikely, but there may be a class of scenarios like this waiting to be discovered. So the idea here would be that you could potentially create physical conditions that would create a baby universe, as it's called, that would kind of split off from the parent universe and have its own Big Bang and potentially have random initial conditions. And you wouldn't only just create one universe, but because there's continual splitting, you would eventually create infinitely many universes by doing this. And in fact, given certain theories of cosmic inflation, there's already an infinite sea of bubble universes within the multiverse that are constantly splitting. So then the question would be, like, if you create infinitely many universes within an already infinite sea of universes, do you increase the total number of universes? And like, how much do you increase it? And so then, assuming that some fraction of those new universes would contain suffering, then it becomes relevant to those kinds of calculations. So then you also want to be able to do things like compare the impact of creating new universes against the impact of reducing suffering within our current universe, which also implies things about the actions of other agents in other universes, because we are logically correlated with other agents in other universes that have a sufficient degree of similarity to ourselves. So then it becomes a complicated calculation about comparing creating universes versus focusing on improving things within our own universe. So yeah, being able to do those sorts of calculations could be relevant. And then I guess another kind of general hard problem is, especially if you believe in a very big multiverse that contains a large number of kinds of structures, for example, Max Tegmark's level 4 multiverse, which contains all mathematical structures, then it becomes again very difficult to like calculate the net effect of your actions across such a big universe. And like, given that it's such a big universe, you would tend to think that maybe scenarios where that kind of universe is actually what exists would be the most important ones, because they're the most total copies of you that exist. And so what you do is replicated the most times. But it's also the kind of universe, the kind of multiverse where it's very hard to calculate the net impact of your actions, because there's so many copies and partial copies of you. So that seems like a really hard problem, like calculating the net impact of your action across such a big multiverse. But that's another example of something where progress could potentially change one's conclusions about what to work on.
Sorry, so did you want to ask a question?
You can go first, it's okay.
Somebody who was very concerned about the potential suffering in the future of simulations and computers and things, could it be reasonable for them to decide that the moral thing for them to do would be to sabotage economic growth or undermine nuclear proliferation or something like that?
To reduce the chance that humanity develops simulations, right?
Yeah.
So it's complicated for a few reasons. One is a sort of strategic point that doing such things would tarnish your cause and make a lot of enemies and might turn people against you. Like, most people agree with the idea of reducing suffering, but if it became associated with extremism, then many fewer people would support it. Like general heuristics about the importance of cooperation and the possibility of positive sum compromises would at least encourage looking for other options. Then there's also like the object level question of whether it actually makes things better, ignoring those side effects. And even there, it's not clear, because it's hard to like, there's no off button for the world, and it's hard to like prevent technological progress without causing, it's hard to completely prevent technological progress. And in trying to do so, you would very likely cause minor catastrophes that would destabilize things without necessarily like preventing it from preventing technological growth from happening in the long run. So what you would probably end up doing would be making the world contain more conflict or like more violence, and that might make people less open to compassion and more like concerned about safety, which could exacerbate pressures for technological arms race or like technology to beat the other parties. And so you could end up maybe even speeding up technological development, because you might make people want to race faster to get like AI or other technologies to secure themselves or to beat other countries. And in the process, like the more people are focused on military supremacy, the less time they have presumably for like AI safety measures or thinking about how to reduce the suffering that results from the explosion of computing power. So those are countervailing factors. It's not obvious which way the calculation goes on balance, but like combined with the heuristics about like not doing things that people regard as evil and the strategic point that it probably hurts your cause in terms of what others think about it. Collectively, those arguments seem pretty strong to oppose, you know, the kinds of things that you're talking about.
How much moral weight do you assign an AI versus an insect, and how do you approach that problem?
So it depends what kind of AI. Present day AIs, I think, generally matter less than insects, because even though, like, in some cases they may be very good at domain specific tasks, but insects can do lots of different things, including like sexual reproduction and, you know, finding food, finding, reacting to different kinds of dangers in different ways. And like there has been a continuous lineage of surviving insects for hundreds of millions of years. So like we can't build a robot that can self-replicate for hundreds of millions of years, or even for like a few generations, except in very, very simple toy environments or something. So insects are just like a lot more robust and computationally efficient than a lot of present day computing systems. Yeah, in the longer term, like AIs will gradually become insect level and then mammal level and so on, at least along different dimensions. It's not the case that there will ever necessarily be an AI that has the exact same set of abilities as an insect. And so you might think the AI matters more on some dimensions and less on other dimensions than insects. Mm-hmm. But in terms of just like adding up the total capacities and abilities of different systems, eventually AIs will surpass insects and even humans. I guess another question could be like whether AIs would be as emotional as animals are. So you could argue that even if an AI had the same intelligence as an insect, maybe it would be less, like it would have fewer of kind of aversive responses or seeking responses that animals have because of searching for rewards and avoiding punishments. So that's another dimension to look at. Like maybe an insect still matters more than an AI of comparable intelligence if the insect has stronger emotions, basically. But especially like reinforcement learning agents or other AI agents that have analogs of reward and punishment, I would consider those to be fairly emotional as well, relative to their levels of intelligence.
So you sort of already touched on this, but can you list some of the dimensions you put the most value on? Like how much they feel, their complexity and their intelligence, which are obviously intertwined. Are there any other dimensions that you consider important? Obviously, yeah, length of life.
Yeah, so I guess there are a lot of possible dimensions here. I consider my approach to consciousness similar to what's called on less wrong complexity of value in ethics in general. So complexity of value is the idea that what humans care about is not easily reducible to a single or small set of components, but it contains lots of different things that people think are important to different degrees. So similarly, with consciousness or with the morally relevant aspects of subjective experience, I would make a similar comment that, like, there are lots of different things that brains do that we might consider important to different degrees, and brains are the kinds of things that, or consciousness in general, is the kind of thing that I think is not easily described by a small description. So a lot of people have theories of consciousness that some of them attempt to make small descriptions, like integrated information theory has a formula to describe consciousness that where consciousness is the integration of information. So the more information you have and the more like it combines together, the more conscious something is. But that's a relatively simple description. And Scott Aronson had a blog post a few years ago about showing how numerical operations on matrices can have extremely high integrated information by that definition, even though they don't seem to be doing the kinds of complex things that we think consciousness should be doing. Another definition is called, another theory of consciousness is called global workspace theory, which says that consciousness is the broadcasting of signals to a wide variety of components that then take actions based on that broadcast information. And so this is, again, something we can see in a wide variety of processes. And by itself, it seems potentially too simple to be a full theory of consciousness. So in general, my sense is that, as with complexity of value in the moral case, there are just lots of different things that cognitive systems do, and we're not going to find a simple way to describe them based on simple properties, but they're just going to be varying degrees of consciousness based on varying degrees of different abilities that we place importance on. But I think current theories of consciousness, even if they're deficient by themselves, can provide inspiration for things that we might care about. So we might care to some extent about integrating information and about broadcasting information to various subcomponents. Another theory of consciousness is called higher order theory, which says that thoughts about lower level, like feelings or processes within your brain, are what give rise to consciousness. So like self-reflection of various sorts could be also considered important. And then, yeah, things like reinforcement learning or memory or the ability to organize a lot of components together into a coherent whole, like to marshal a lot of different resources to solve a problem. Things like that could all be considered relevant to consciousness. So yeah, those are just some examples.
If we had a sort of an approximately human level artificially intelligent agent, and it was able to sort of communicate in natural language, and we asked it whether it was conscious and it said no, or it said yes, would its answer to that question matter at all to you, do you think, or would that just be no information on whether it should have any moral relevance?
Pretty small information, because I guess it would matter a bit more insofar as that answer was hooked up to the right kinds of knowledge about its own self. So, but that knowledge, if we're programming it and we can see the code, then we would already have that knowledge independently. So like, so one trivial example would be, you could write a program where you ask it, are you conscious? And it says yes. Or it says no. And so that gives us very little information, because the answer that it gives is not, does not originate from an inspection of its internals, an inspection of the kinds of things that we're looking for. So yeah, if we've got criteria for consciousness, like the kinds of cognitive abilities that I mentioned, then those are the things that we would be looking for. And unless the AI's response is also looking at those things to determine its answer, then it wouldn't matter too much.
So you based on the table of your beliefs, you put a low but non-trivial percentage chance on moral realism. If moral realism were true, do you think we can make any meaningful predictions about what frameworks may be more or less likely? For example, it seems to me that it would a good candidate would be that there's inherent value in the valence of experience, and that there's a sort of a elegance of symmetry at a sort of computational potential level between suffering and pleasure.
I missed the last sentence. Something about computational pleasure.
Seems to me that there's to hand wave a little bit, that there would be an elegance and a symmetry between the universe's sort of computational ability to produce pleasure or pain.
Rather than, for example, just disvalue on pain. So yeah, the moral realism probability, it's very low, and the main reason I have it above zero is epistemic modesty. I still don't understand why people believe in moral realism. And so it's sort of like, I mean, I'm not quite sure what's meant by moral realism even. So it's mostly there because there's some probability that either I haven't heard the right arguments or my ability to process them is faulty. And there are enough smart people who disagree that I might just be misguided. I can't comment too much on that, but if it did exist, I mean, then you might have some intuitions about what it would look like if it did exist. For example, whether moral theories should be simple and conform to Occam's razor in some sense. And if so, then if you thought moral theories should be simple, then maybe you would expect the ontologies that they refer to be simple as well. Like, they might refer more to fundamental physics than to complex things. So say there was a simple moral theory, it might prescribe things about fundamental physics, maybe most of all, because happiness and suffering are very complex, high-level phenomena, similar to like life, say, and there's not a crisp physical definition of happiness or suffering. So it would seem unlikely that a simple moral theory would talk about happiness or suffering. Maybe it would talk about like entropy, like the universe's utility function is to maximize entropy, you could say, or some other thing about quarks or superstrings or whatever. But I haven't thought too much about it because I don't really understand moral realism, though.
On that point, from a reducing suffering perspective, you mentioned that there's a potentially fundamental suffering in physics, for example, might dominate an unexpected value based on what we currently understand. Do you put much credence on the argument from a reducing suffering perspective that it might be useful to make sure humanity or some sort of intelligent organization or civilization sticks around to ponder those questions, given that there does seem to be somewhat of an altruistic urge more than a sadistic urge?
Maybe. So in one piece I have about risks of astronomical future suffering, I mention that there might be, that one reason why space colonization and intellectual and technological progress could be good is if there are ways to reduce suffering that don't entail a risk of increasing suffering. So if there, in general, the more suffering the universe currently contains, the more important it is for like human values to exist, because there's more to accomplish by sticking around. So if there are currently large sources of suffering, such as in fundamental physics, then it becomes more plausible that we can accomplish net suffering reduction in the future. The main concern I have is that there are also probably ways to expand the amount of suffering that exists. And so, especially when you're talking about fundamental physics, my guess is that the most obvious way to change the amount of suffering that exists in fundamental physics would be to change the amount of fundamental physics itself that exists, such as what I mentioned before, creating lab universes, or like if you can change the dynamics of fundamental physics in some way that either increases or decreases the amount of like activity that it contains, whatever that means exactly. But like if you consider one conformation of physics to be more sentient than another, for example, then I worry that people might favor the increased sentience conformation of physics, because there's also happiness in physics potentially. And so like if you care enough about happiness, or like insofar as people generally favor increasing the amount of sentience that exists, then there's a risk of making things worse rather than better.
So you say you're just not at all convinced about moral realism, but also that you're a negative utilitarian. And so I'm interested in how you consider negative utilitarian non-realist, and like what your opinion is on that, and also what you think the best argument for negative utilitarianism is.
Yes, so there's nothing special about negative utilitarianism and non-realism. It's just you can in general combine any ethical theory with non-realism. So it basically amounts to saying that I'm an agent who has certain goals that include reducing suffering, and like suffering makes me feel bad to think about, and I want there to be less of it. So and like I hope that other agents will share that concern, and using moral language can be one way to communicate with people about what I care about, as well as to persuade them to care more about it. Arguments for negative utilitarianism, my own fundamental reason for being negative utilitarian beyond anything else is considering examples of extreme suffering, such as burning alive or being eaten alive by predators or things like that, and thinking that from my own perspective, that would be so bad that I would trade away anything to prevent it, and then realizing that like many agents during that process would feel the same, namely that at some point the suffering would get so intense that they would trade away anything to prevent it. So naively, if you just look at that trade-off that they're making, that would suggest a negative utilitarian standpoint that like no amount of other values is worth it. Unfortunately, you can also make other trade-offs, like a person during a calm state of mind very often would accept some amount of torture in return for some amount of additional happiness. And there might even be agents, like artificial agents that you could create that would be experiencing so much happiness that they would accept any amount of mild suffering to continue experiencing the happiness. So there's a fundamental arbitrariness as far as what trade-offs you accept. There's no objective way to do interpersonal comparisons of utility. So the person being tortured who will give anything to make it stop has like infinite negative utility on torture, but other people would have finite negative utility on torture compared against finite utility on happiness. And there's no principled way to combine those numbers. They're just different preferences of different agents or different moments of the same agent. And so fundamentally, you just have to like choose some agents to side with over others because they're incompatible preferences. So yeah, negative utilitarians just side with the ones experiencing torture who want it to stop at all costs, basically. You can make other arguments that are more theoretical, such as the idea, especially if you're a preference utilitarian, you can say things like preference satisfaction is good because it removes a deficit, basically. So you can think of preferences as debts that are waiting to be filled or waiting to be paid off. And this view is called anti-frustrationism. So basically the idea that the reason it's good to fulfill a preference is that you prevent the dissatisfaction of the preference. And so it's similar to the second noble truth of Buddhism, basically, that suffering comes from craving. So like when you have a preference for something, you're craving something, and then making the preference stop either by fulfilling it or by getting rid of the preference itself removes the disvalue there. So from that perspective, happiness is good because it prevents preference dissatisfaction. But for the same reason, like being in a flow state or meditating could also be equally good from that perspective. And likewise, not creating beings would also avoid preference frustration. I'm often curious what Buddhism would look like without reincarnation, because with reincarnation, you can't change the population size, because if you kill a being, it comes back somewhere else. So Buddhists don't have the option of population, don't have population ethics, basically.
Maybe there were strands of Buddhism and they've just died out.
On a mild animal suffering, what are some sort of roadmaps do you think are possible that humanity can take to reduce the suffering of wild animals?
There are different opinions on this. So some people like David Pierce favor technological approaches where humans develop ways to re-engineer nature to reduce suffering. Pierce's current most famous proposal is using gene drives to spread genes throughout wild populations that would cause animals to experience less suffering in various ways, such as reducing pain sensitivity or maybe improving their welfare in other ways. I'm more skeptical about that kind of proposal because I think it's very costly to develop those interventions. So few people are going to want to do it, combined with the fact that it would probably significantly change ecological dynamics. And so people would also oppose it on the grounds that it has unpredictable side effects. Even with gene drives, people debate whether it's okay to eliminate mosquitoes, for example, to save a million human lives per year. So like if we can't even convince people to use gene drives there, it seems unlikely we could do it. We could convince them to do riskier things to help wild animals. Other people favor promoting concern for wild animal suffering in general so that in the longer term future, our descendants will have more concern for it and take action on it. One simple form of this is just if we spread more concern for wild animal suffering, then it becomes less likely that people will spread it in new places, such as terraforming other planets or seeding other planets in the galaxy where life might take hold, or recreating it in ancestor simulations or other kinds of simulations of alien ecosystems or things like that. Then the approach that I also favor for reducing it in the short term is like researching and then pushing on existing human environmental policies in various directions. So humans already have enormous impacts on the environment, and we can either increase or decrease those depending on whether we think that impact is positive or negative for wild animals. In many cases, this leads to conclusions that are in opposition to environmentalism, but there might be some cases where that's not the case, or some cases where at least other factors override that problem. So one example that that I've suggested and that I want to look into more is whether saving lives such as through Against Malaria Foundation would also reduce wild animal suffering. And the argument there would be that humans in general tend to like appropriate land and biomass that could otherwise feed insects, and like many people think that humans on balance reduce the number of wild animals that exist. And if that's the case, then saving lives could further reduce the number of wild animals. But many people consider things like AMF to be beneficial. So you don't have the same kind of backlash as you do for forms of like habitat loss that don't have a strong upside to them. So there might be cases like that. And then maybe other cases as well where environmentalism happens to agree with wild animal suffering. So for example, I'm pretty uncertain about the net impact of climate change on wild animal suffering. There are some reasons to think climate change could increase suffering, such as by increasing insect populations in higher latitudes, maybe increasing plant growth. Although there are other reasons to think it might decrease suffering, such as in the oceans by reducing phytoplankton productivity, potentially. So the questions are sometimes complicated, but there may be some things that we can find that seem more likely good than bad. Another example that where humans might be aligned with reducing suffering is eutrophication, at least mild eutrophication, that is adding nutrients to like rivers and lakes, can increase algae growth, which can feed more zooplankton, but that's also sometimes not liked by humans because it makes the lakes less transparent and can increase pollutants in the water supply system and things. So there may be some cases like that where wild animal suffering aligns with human interests.
Anyone who hasn't asked a question yet wanna ask something?
Can I go again?
Yeah, absolutely.
I guess like, I'm sorry that before this call I only had time to read your sort of brief summary of your views on your website. And you talked about sort of, you would roughly consider sort of one human in pain to be the equivalent of maybe 11 rats or 240 fruit flies kind of thing. I guess I know it's difficult to sort of, it can be difficult to kind of communicate your moral intuition, but could you do like the best you could to explain how you come up with that?
Yeah, and my specific ratios fluctuate based on random factors or what I learned most recently and things. Like at present, I might say more like 10 to the fourth fruit flies or so. But either way, it's a non-trivial importance of fruit fly suffering. So the naive view is that all animals matter equally, or like if they're conscious at all, then they're equally conscious. That's at least the view that many animal rights activists hold, especially like the quantitative ones who try to reduce the total number of factory farmed animals killed or something without distinguishing chickens from pigs. Another view is to say that you should weigh by like a pretty much linear function of say number of neurons, because the more neurons you have, the more cognitive operations you can perform. And for example, if there are hedonic hotspots, basically areas of the brain that are essential for pleasure and maybe similar things for pain, then you might think that twice as many neurons firing in those regions would matter twice as much, just because there's because those processes are in some sense being instantiated twice as much, for a similar reason as we care twice as much about two different animals running roughly similar brain processes. And you can make similar arguments about split brain patients. If you split a human's brain down the middle, you can get two somewhat independent halves that don't communicate as much. And it's, if you don't weigh moral importance by brain size, then you would think that splitting the brain almost doubles the value of the person. You can also argue that there might be subcomponents of a big brain that are similar to the small brain. Like the split brain example illustrates that, but then also even smaller subcomponents that compete for influence on the larger brain might themselves be considered similar to a smaller brain. So I think that argument's fairly good for saying that we should at least weigh by some increasing function of brain size. I tend not to weigh moral importance linearly in the number of neurons, because I think bigger brains might be seen as the subcomponents of big brains may not be as fully agent-like and fully autonomous as smaller insects or smaller brains. So like an insect is a complete agent that can do all the relevant functions on its own, whereas like some component of the human brain, like say the visual processing system or something, doesn't really operate on its own within a complete environment. So the bigger brain components could be seen more like cogs in a machine and might be less kind of less of a whole individual in some sense. So that's part of why I give less weight to big brains. Also, big brains may have more neurons just for higher resolution of computation, or like, you know, we have lots of visual processing neurons just to get a high sensory resolution, not necessarily because we're doing dramatically different algorithms on top of those sensory inputs. We are doing more on top of those inputs, but like if we have 100 times more visual neurons, we're not necessarily doing 100 times more types of computations. So those are some reasons to give to increase the moral value of to weigh the moral value of a bigger brain less than linearly in its size. And so for the particular numbers that you quoted there, I think it was something like square root of number of neurons or something like that was my function for value. So that's roughly where those numbers came from. And that's certainly not a, that's not the final answer on it, because ideally you would do a more detailed analysis of exactly what abilities different animals have and like how big their emotional regions are and things like that. But, just as a quick way to make guesses before knowing that information. Yeah.
Does FRI do any work on human suffering at all, or future human suffering?
It depends what you mean by human, I guess. Usually we focus on animals in the short term because they're more numerous. Even if you count neurons, they're more numerous than animals are more numerous than humans. And in the longer term, I guess it's unclear whether human type minds will be will exist in significant numbers in the far future. If you take Nick Bostrom's example in Astronomical Waste, a paper that he wrote suggesting that like at least in principle you could simulate, I don't know, 10 to the 38th human lifetimes given the resources within our supercluster of the cosmos, then there would be, if you take that scenario literally, then there would be enormous numbers of human minds, simulated human minds. And so humans would be very important to the calculation. With most uncontrolled AI scenarios, it's very unlikely you would have significant numbers of human minds, because they're not like the most useful ways to compute most problems, to solve most problems. There might be some number of human minds for like ancestor simulations, or modeling evolution on other planets or things like that, but there would be many more alien minds than specifically human minds in that case. And then even for human controlled features, it's plausible that like either evolutionary pressures or just like transhumanist desires would lead most agents to become superhuman or different than human in their constitution. Yeah, like I guess we don't specifically distinguish human versus non-human, but my guess is that probably most of the expected number of minds in the future would not be very human-like. They might, although they might share human values to some degree, and they might use some of the same types of cognitive algorithms, but it's not really clear.
Okay, it sounds like you guys are mostly focused on these other things, which are either way more numerous or more likely to exist in the future, and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions?
I keep having this sense of being unable to visualize. I guess what I'm looking for is a minimum viable product version of a system that would suffer. I can, for whatever reason, imagine an artificial intelligence that's similarly, of similar intelligence to myself suffering. That's probably just my projection fallacy. But for something like an insect or these sub-processes that you were talking about, I just can't fathom them suffering. I don't understand why there's concern about that. And I have personification bias, so I actually relate deeply to your videos on insects. And I'm glad that you create those, but I also recognize that as being personification bias or anthropomorphic bias, something like that. So I guess I'm trying to catch up my intellectual side. The emotional side seems to agree with you, but that's possibly biased. My intellectual side just can't conceptualize, and I don't understand how these things could suffer. Is there a way to explain that that will help me?
Yeah, so it's true that it's personification or anthropomorphism, but in some sense that's... you could consider that to be part of ethics or part of your moral values. So like if you think about empathy with humans, that's also a form of anthropomorphism, sort of, like in the sense that if you have visceral empathy with another person, that's done by activating parts of your own brain that correspond to what the other agent is experiencing. And so it's not so much anthropomorphism, but like you're projecting the other person into yourself. And so you're simulating the other person with your own self. So basically, like, you're responding. You're responding to a model of the other person that's kind of tweaked to be yourself. I'm not necessarily explaining that well, but like, you're projecting the other person onto your own emotions. And then you're being motivated by those emotions. So anthropomorphism is sort of a more extended version of that. And one reason it's not a good idea to do it to extremes is that other animals share less of the cognitive machinery that we share. So when you simulate another human with your brain, a lot of the simulation is accurate, although some of it may not be if you're like, projecting your own specific feelings in ways that are not correct. But the more different from you the mind is that you're simulating, the more inaccurate the simulation will be. But to some extent, like insofar as you capture something accurate with your mental simulation, then it can still be valuable from an ethical perspective to do that kind of simulation. So I think the one way to think about the argument for the suffering of insects or other simpler minds is like what general properties of what humans do we care about, and then can we see simpler instances of those in smaller minds? So like if you generalize at a high level what it is that's bad about suffering, like it's a emotional state that you want to avoid and that causes you to try to avoid it in the future, and it can trigger strong effects on your attention and strong memories that last into the future. And you can come up with like very coarse-grained general statements about what suffering is, and then you can look for at least simpler instances of those kinds of properties in other minds. And then the details of exactly how those things are implemented are very complex in human brains, but at least the outlines can be present elsewhere. So Carl Shulman calls the complex features of brains bells and whistles. Basically, you've got like the core processes of, say, reinforcement learning and memory and like avoidance of negative stimuli and things like that. And then in human brains, those are augmented with like high resolution of sensory inputs and the ability to form a model of oneself and construct verbal declarations about one's own conscious state and hook up that information to various other complex cognitive processes. But those can be seen as bells and whistles, basically, like they're extra stuff added to the core processes. And so that extra stuff may increase the amount that we care about the brain, but it's there's no fundamental transition in like it's not as though a human brain is doing fundamentally different things than the insect brain. It's doing similar things at a higher level of complexity, and maybe some abilities are specifically human, like the ability to have complex language describing one's emotions, for example. But as long as you don't consider any of those abilities essential to consciousness, then it's going to be a gradual spectrum of consciousness where the more abilities you have, the more important you are, but there's not a single cutoff point where you stop caring. So at least that's my view. And so that leads to a sort of panpsychism where I consider any physical system to be conscious to a non-zero degree, but it might be an extremely small degree for very simple things like an electron would matter like astronomically less than even an insect. But
I guess I agree that just because something is far simpler doesn't mean it doesn't experience suffering or is unimportant. I definitely, you know, feel bad if I see an animal that's suffering and things like that, and I think that animals do suffer. Though, you know, justifying that intellectually would be very difficult for me. I don't know how to go about that. I guess another way to phrase my question is, how does suffering work?
Well, yeah, so as far as I can tell, it's this complex collection of things that brains do. Like one of the most important parts would presumably be avoidance, like negative stimuli come into the brain and then you try to recoil from them. Of course, that's an extremely simple process that's found throughout nature. So like even an electron can be pushed away from another electron or something due to both being negatively charged. So by itself, that process might be too simple, but then you add other complexity like having the ability to like higher resolution of the sensory inputs, like rather than just some single stimulus that makes you go away, you have a more complex perception of like visual inputs or mechanical inputs like touch inputs. And then reinforcement learning, I also think is important, the ability to generalize about in what kinds of contexts you experience an event that triggers negative punishment in your brain, and then try to avoid those contexts in similar situations. Maybe like the ability to have different kinds of memories. So learning is in some sense one form of memory, in the sense that your responses to a given context change over time in response to things that you experience. But another form of memory could be like episodic memory and having specific recall of, say, the negative experience that you had. So like you can store store a snapshot of the sensory experiences that you were having at the time, and then recall them in new contexts where they're applicable. And then I think from that point, adding additional cognitive abilities just enhances the total degree of sophistication of the mind. I don't think there's like a more sharp way to define the boundary of suffering, but I think it's just a lot of little things like that combined together.
My intuition is different. I think that things could be much more clear. So for instance, with your particle example, there are, say, two electrons pushing each other away. Who's to say that going away is bad? There are times when I want to travel, and so I go away from my town. That there's stuff pushing other stuff away, to characterize that as bad is me applying my own perception to that. So unless the electrons can also judge the situation and decide that the situation is bad, then how would they experience that as bad? There are some human experiences, just to come back up to this other level, that are going to be bad whether I take a moment to judge them as bad or not. So actually, I think my brain tends to judge them as bad in the amygdala, which is a different location than the conscious part. Let's just use physical pain for an example. That I experience as bad in a way that seems to have nothing to do with judgment. It's not that I'm judging the pain as bad, it's just sort of, I'm sort of wired to experience that as suffering, I guess. Unless an electron is wired to experience being pushed away as bad, I don't know how that could be suffering. So to me, it looks like there must be an additional component somewhere. It's not just the being pushed away that would signal suffering. It also have to be some other thing. You would either have to judge the experience as bad or be wired to experience that as bad in order for it to be suffering. But then it seems like there needs also to be some sort of machinery to experience badness, like to experience the torture of suffering. Otherwise, it's maybe more of a reflex, like if the doctor hits my knee with the hammer, it moves. Just because my knee moved doesn't mean that it hurts. It feels a little bit funny, but I'm not suffering. It's not torture. It's sort of amusing. So there needs to be some system in there that also experiences badness. So to me, there needs to be at least three components. But then again, I just started thinking about this to break it down. So for all I know, it's actually far more complicated than that. Has anybody done work to write down all of the things that would be required for suffering to happen to, like, see if we can detect these types of systems anywhere?
I'm going to plug in my laptop. My battery's running low.
Just as a natural pause, does anyone else have any questions? Just because anyone has questions, has anything quick?
Yep, I'm back. I plugged it in. So.
Great. So on similar lines, I think one of the interesting things about being an anti-realist is it's all a bit arbitrary, and we're all sort of just working off our moral intuitions. And obviously our moral intuitions come from not rationality, but, you know, millions of years of evolution, which may not necessarily result in consistent intuitions. It may not result in rational intuitions. So how do we resolve the fact that we're trying to rationalize something that may inherently not be consistent or rational to any degree?
And should I answer the other question, or are we saving that to the end about the electrons and stuff?
To your discretion.
Okay, yeah. I'll do yours first, but then I'll get back to the electrons. I guess it's ultimately the answer to that can also be non-realist, basically. The reason that we apply logic to things is because we want to, and due to like the fact that logic works in engineering and other contexts for practical purposes, we come to think that it's a valid thing to use to judge our moral theories as well. But yeah, I mean, so for example, one anecdote with this is when I was studying statistics in high school, obviously the mean of a distribution is an important concept. And so you do a lot of calculating of expected values in statistics. And so then thinking about expected utility theory becomes very natural because you're already used to thinking of expected values as something that you want to manipulate or work with. And of course, there are other arguments in favor of using expected values, but that's just an illustration of how, like, certain things that you have experience with or that your culture values then can be part of what you value when deciding on your moral intuitions. So yeah, I don't have a better answer than that other than to say that most people, including myself, care about applying reason to these questions, and it somehow feels like we're doing a better job of applying our empathy in the right ways when we use rationality, but there's not a better answer than that necessarily.
I'll just say we'll have 10 more minutes and then round up, if that's okay.
Sounds good.
Great. Do you want to answer Kathy's previous question?
Yes. So I don't have a great answer here, like a thoroughly worked out proposal, but I think what you say about judging the thing to be bad is a relevant consideration. Like, so, and I think this is part of where the motivation for higher order theories of consciousness comes from, namely that you can have your brain do various things, but what matters is judging it to be a certain way, like either judging it to be good or bad, or even judging yourself to be conscious in the first place. There's one line of thinking that says we're most conscious when we're asking ourselves whether we're conscious, and we're not necessarily conscious to the same degree if we're not thinking about the question. Susan Blackmore compares it to having a fridge light. You always see the fridge light on when you open it, but that's because it comes on when you open it. So yeah, from one perspective, higher level judgments about our consciousness could be quite important to them. And so that's true both for being conscious at all as well as for feeling pain. So you could say that if you're not aware of lower level painful stimuli, then they don't matter as much, and most of us have that intuition. Like if we don't notice that we're in pain, it doesn't matter as much. So I guess my general response to that is just to say that it's complicated to think about what goes into a judgment, and like verbal report is one obvious way to delineate a judgment, but obviously just verbal reports can't be the end of the story, because you could have patients who can't speak or patients who don't know how to speak but still have very similar brains in other respects. And like verbalizing one's brain state is sort of the end of a longer process. There's a lot more going on in the brain, and then verbalizing it is sort of like the end part of that process. And it seems like the stuff that happened before you put it into words should also be important. So like if you say, if you physically injure yourself and then eventually you say that hurts, it seems like there's probably something before the verbal declaration that hurts that also matters. So then, yeah, I guess it seems to me like there's a fuzzy boundary of process of making judgments happens. And you could think that different brain processes implicitly make certain judgments in various forms. Like if say the amygdala or something is, I don't know if that's the fear part of the brain or something, but say the amygdala is activated, then that's sort of an implicit communication to the other parts of the brain that a certain judgment has been made, namely that there's something to be afraid of or whatever. So it's not made in words, but it's made in neural activation. So you can make, like, if you kind of follow this line of reasoning, you can say that different components of the brain make different implicit judgments, maybe in a language that we can't understand directly. And so then it's not really clear where this judgment happens and where all the physical processing or like mechanical processing, where the mechanical processing ends and where the judging begins. In some senses, everything is a judgment and a mechanical process together at different levels of complexity. So you were still left with the puzzle about the electron, like, is the electron happy to be moved away or in pain to be moved away? So that's a tricky issue. Like, I guess I would go back to the anthropomorphism thing and say that we decide what kinds of emotions to attribute to it. Fundamentally it's like a simple system that where our concepts of happiness and suffering don't really apply very much because it's so much simpler than the rich mechanics that happiness and suffering refer to when we talk about them in animal brains. But insofar as we do want to apply those concepts at all to the electron, then it's up to us to anthropomorphize it and give it, like, say that it's happy or sad or in pain. And so because the concepts don't apply very strongly to it, that's another reason to not care about it very much. And there's a general problem with what's called functionalism in the philosophy of mind, where, like, the interpretation of any given physical process is not determined strictly. And the electron thing is one example. Like, you can interpret that in through different lenses, but in general, any computation or any physical system can be interpreted as any computation depending on how you map physical processes into, like, components of the algorithm. So that's a general issue that has to be worked out.
Really fascinating to collaborate with you about this. I have a lot of thoughts on how minds work. I've been studying on my own what makes humans tick, basically, or how do we work for like 20 years. So I feel like I'm ready to really dive in and try to pick apart suffering and how that works and what sorts of systems might or might not be able to experience suffering. Would you find value in such a collaboration?
Potentially. Also, Luke Melhauser at Open Philanthropy Project is working on something very, like, basically this question, roughly. So you might also be interested. But feel free to email me and we can talk about it.
Okay, awesome. Where should I find your email address? Is that your website?
Are you happy for me to share your email address with Kathy?
Yeah, sure. You can. Sure. There's also a contact form on my website, but yeah.
All right. Well, if there are no further questions, I might round it up. Can we have a big round of applause for Brian? Thank you very, very much for talking with us. It was very fascinating.
Thanks. It was fun.
Glad to hear it.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
You too.
It's time almost.
Bye.
Bye.